Hey guys, so in a different video, I talked about my dad's kind of conspiracy daydream or conspiracy hypothesis, I would like to call it, about the end of the world according to the Bible. And so my dad's theory is that there's all these countries around the world, and there's no country in the world, no governing body in the world that doesn't have a debt, that they lend money to other countries, but they also borrow money from other countries. United States, for example, is indebted to China, Russia, all these different countries. China, in return, is indebted to United States, Russia. Russia in itself is indebted to China, United States. And all these countries are like this. So is there a country without a debt? And the obvious answer, and I don't know if this is a true answer, honestly, seems to be that no, there isn't. Except my dad argues the Vatican, the Catholic Church, has no debt. Catholic Church has properties all around the world. Actually, this is actually fact. The biggest real estate owner of New York City is the Catholic Church. Catholic Church owns the most land in New York City. So that's one example of one city. And that might be the case in many other cities, many other countries around the world. The second biggest landowner in New York City is New York University, NYU. So that's a big, that's the comparison there. So I don't know if that's still true today, but that was true in 2008. I don't know how much of that would change in 5 years, but I'm pretty sure that ranking still holds. So from this, my dad would conclude that the Antichrist might likely come out of the Catholic Church, because Catholic Church is this entity that has funneled all the world's resources and would eventually have the power and enough resources to control the people of the world and to monitor everyone and to control governments and control the governing bodies of governments and their subjects along with it. And so there would be an Antichrist that comes out of the Catholic Church, and that would lead to reigning by Satan, ruling the world for over thousands of years, or 1,000 years, as is the prophecy of the Bible, because my dad, after all, he takes the Bible literally from his translations. He doesn't know, well, he has basic rudimentary understanding of Hebrew, he doesn't know Greek, so he is... his interpretation is from translations, so I don't know. But regardless, I do feel like a lot of Christians actually have this view, especially like young earth creationists, kind of have this view that somehow in the near future, the world is going to end, because that's what the Bible says. This world will end, Satan will rule it for over 1,000 years. During that time, all the true believers will be in heaven spending time with God. And that 1,000-year period is kind of that mourning period or that horrible time in the world, so that people who are non-believers will learn their lesson, and eventually Jesus will come down to earth for the second time, but this time gloriously, with angels at his feet and from the clouds, and will come back down to earth as he did once before according to Christianity, and will save the world from Satan, and Satan will be defeated forevermore, and everyone will be, even the dead will rise from their graves, and happy ending. It's kind of the apocalyptic believings of a lot of various Christians. I'm quite not sure where Catholics would stand on this, but I'm pretty sure they also have their own idea of what the apocalypse or what the Armageddon of the world would look like. So I talked about that, I shared about that, but this viewpoint, regardless of whether you think, the Catholic Pope could be the Antichrist, because that's pretty crazy thing to argue for. But that's a detail that my dad doesn't really care about if that's wrong. What he knows to be certain is that there will be an Antichrist, and that Satan will rule the world for thousands of years, for 1,000 years, sorry, I keep making that mistake, for 1,000 years. During that time, the non-believers will be left behind, and after that time, Jesus will come back to earth, and everything will be victorious for God and his people. That's a basic kind of, I kind of really, you know, butchered it by, like, just summarizing it. I'm pretty sure I, you know, misrepresented a lot of it. So, in a way, my argument would be like a straw man argument. But I'm not arguing against this. What I want to point out is the negative impact this kind of viewpoint has in living our life. Because you believe, my dad believes, that no matter what we do, the Bible prophesies that this world will end and Satan will rule this world for 1,000 years. No matter what we do, this makes the biggest impact on this, me personally, is sometimes we discuss, because I'm vegan, for ethical and environmental reasons. And, you know, the amount of resources it takes to create animal meat and animal secretions, so much more harmful to the environment than if we, you know, if that amount of food was instead plant food. So much destruction in the environment for that purpose. So I take it, you know, in order to, you know, do the least harm as possible to this planet, to the least environmental harm at least, veganism is the best thing to do. If there were more vegans in the world, there were more vegetarians in the world, the environmental harm we do to planet Earth would be, there would be less harm. That's kind of what I believe in. We come to this, and there's always this stalemate that happens when I argue with my dad, and I don't argue with my dad that much. I don't want to give this impression that my dad and I always, like, have these gigantic philosophical debates and bickerings, whatnot. We don't, not really. But there are times that we do. And my dad and I, we kind of enjoy this kind of thing for some reason. I guess I, you know, got that from him, or he got that from me. I don't know, we have the same set of genes on some level. We share some, you know, I'm his son. So that makes sense, perhaps. In any case, we get to a stalemate, you know. He argues a strong case, or I actually do not think it's a strong case, but he argues, you know, fiercely and passionately. And I'd argue fiercely and passionately, and to him, I'm not making a strong case, although I think I'm making a strong case. Whatever. Get to the stalemate. And it always kind of ends with him going, well, it doesn't really matter, you know, because this world is going to end anyway. Like, you can try your best to protect this planet Earth the best way you can, or you can do your best, but, you know, this is all going to end. What matters is not life here, but life, the afterlife, eternal life given to us as gift from God. This is fatalistic. When you already know that it's all done for, that it's pointless to keep trying, then of course you would give up. And maybe he's right. I don't know. There might be a 1%, I know, 0.0000000000000000001% possibility that Christianity is correct. I'll give him that. Might be true. And so in that case, yeah, all our efforts, not just my efforts, but because they're, you know, all the environmentalists and in all the lawyers and advocates and the tree hugger people, maybe all their efforts are for nothing, because after all, in the end, the Antichrist will rule the world and the world will end and Satan will rule the world for 1,000 years and there will be second coming and life on this world would not matter at all. Maybe that's the case, but it just bothers me that this mindset gets you to accept, to just give up, like, just not care about this world, because life eternally, like, having life for infinite amount of time, of course, numerically, would be more important than 100 years, or 80 years, or 50 years, or 30 years of living on this planet. Numerically, comparatively, that makes sense. But like that, you're assuming that it will come true, which might not even be true. And if that's the case, and you give up on this planet and don't even try, and it ends up like hurting the planet more so than it would have if you didn't believe in that and actually tried hard to do the least harm as possible, then what you've done is you left your descendants, your sons, your grandsons, with a worse planet or with a worse system, and that no one is gonna. They're not going to be held accountable for that, because by then they'll be dead, or of old age, and not able to really do anything. That's disappointing to me. This worldview is fatalistic in that sense. It has you giving up because, hey, what's the point? It's all going to end anyway. I think that's one of the most dangerous things about, I want to say religion, but like, I guess I would limit, I don't know too much about other religions, so I guess I'll just limit it to Christianity at this point. I'm pretty sure there are many other religions that have this theory about the apocalypse and Armageddon. I'm not really sure if Judaism does, or if Islam does. But Christianity, for sure, a lot of sects in Christianity has this view. Some denominations have completely different ideas about the apocalypse, and so, whatever, the end point is that this world will end, that this life currently doesn't really matter. This life is a preparation for the next life, with eternal life, with God. So it makes this life so trivial, so meaningless. We give up. There's a book that I've, that was like a devotional to me when I was a born again, when I considered myself a born again Christian. And it was like, we have to die on the cross. We have to follow the lead of Jesus Christ and not partake in the ways of the world, and the ways of the world might be conservation, might be, ethical sensibilities, might be, treating gay people like people, except it's just, they have this box, they have all their beliefs in this box, and they call it the Bible, and it's not necessarily the Bible, it's their interpretation of the Bible, because they took some verses out here that they like, whatever. It's selective reading at best. And from that, they have this whole, their politics, their science is wired around this thing. And I think it has so much negative potential, so much potential for destruction and harm. And I think that's the one negative thing that I really have to look out for, because when my dad says stuff like that, I'm just left stifled and baffled, and I no longer want to continue the discussion. I'm just like, well, if that's your end argument, then what's the point of having this discussion at all? Because it doesn't matter, right? What the only thing that matters is that you go to heaven, and that I don't go to hell. But your beliefs will make you go to heaven, but I will end up in hell. So son and father will be split, because God is all justice. I don't. That's a topic for a different matter. But it's just something that really bothers me about his whole theory. What bothers me is not that it is his theory, but that is the theory of so many religious people in the world. That so many people have this belief without being aware of what it actually means, and that's scary. It's terrifying. Anyway, that's my whole video on this topic. If you guys enjoyed, share your thoughts, whatever. Cheers.